I have no idea if I'm live. I don't know.
Welcome back to WhatsApp.
What do you mean you have no idea if you're live?
I mean, I'm on Wirecast and I did put in the details, but how do I find out if this is going somewhere?
Well, you go on the YouTube channel.
Okay, and where would it appear?
By refreshing, it should be there. It has to be aware of what's going on. Videos. Videos. No, nothing is happening.
Yeah.
Weird.
But you can definitely post it in any conversation.
Strange. That's why we should have done the app, because I knew it would work and we only had 5 minutes to make it work.
I mean, this is the...
Yeah, but on this, you really literally just need to type the mail and then it really does it. Oh, it works!
I think we're here.
Okay, let me go check on my...
How big a file can you airdrop?
I don't know. How big the file you got?
Pretty big, actually. Yeah. It's like 4 gigabytes.
It's not working on my
Mac. Or floating, yeah.
So, there's a stream running.
How many watching? Zero.
Because the stream is not online. I mean, I can't access it. Do you have a link to this stream?
That's definitely droppable.
Yeah?
Okay, so there we go.
Okay, can you send this link on YouTube, for example? Well, I mean, so on Facebook?
I put it on the WhatsApp.
Okay.
Oh yeah, like, and maybe a little tinkle.
Yeah, yeah. Ah, should I do a tinkle?
But, you don't. What? It feels like it's a move to make.
Okay.
But don't make it too nice, because it's going to be like the only nice clip you have in the video.
I think that's also quite good.
We also need to have like a professional color grading on it.
I'm just gonna sit here for the lecture.
Hello.
Is
private what?
Live stream.
Am I on television?
Yeah, it's private, man.
Okay. Alright.
Is this for Andy?
Yeah, it's private.
Not that one.
Which
that one's quite intense.
It's too much.
What are you doing?
I'm making a special effects shot.
One for like...
It's still private. I don't even know where the option to set it to not private is.
Huh.
It's,
stream options? Oh, yeah, here. Yeah?
Do I save that somewhere, or is that just happening though?
I'll change the save. Can you check?
Cool.
We can change the color.
Why that square?
No!
Yeah!
Yeah, you can only change the color.
What is actually happening? I'm worried
that's going to get right out.
Yeah,
you're going to
have to fight from a wise man.
It's not the
didn't share it with anyone yet. So
that's why we have to track.
No.
Yeah. HDMI?
That's legitimately going to run out of battery before it goes up.
So where is the camera?
Ah, excellent. Thank you.
It's this one?
Yeah. That will appear in a few minutes.
There's a delay.
Wow. Great.
No, man, not at all. Man, it's like, really? Yeah.
So, Chris, you want to
I have it.
This one is special.
Hello. Hi, this is Leila. I have a lot on the screen.
Being here, and I think our main link is that I'm based in Athens. Other than that, I have been actively doing exhibitions and curating shows and setting up different types of institutions. So I'm going to briefly introduce myself to you with a couple of things, because for the last couple of years, a lot of things that I have been doing have been shifting. Maybe and I can pose some questions. It can be a bit boring because most curatorial curators, when they speak about their work, they have to narrate a lot, but please stop me if you want. And then I can speak to you about another endeavor that I'm doing at the moment, for which I don't have a lot of images, which is contra actually my profession, but this is actually a very long process that includes a lot of words, so you're going to hear a lot of words also out of me. But first things first, maybe I thought, I have two clips that ever since you invited me to come to speak to you have been stuck into my mind for different reasons, and maybe they're disjointed. But I want to show you first because I know that you have invited as an oracle before. Last year, as you probably know, we were all privileged that half of Documenta or the other half of Documenta was happening in Athens, and Lipo was a regular guest. He, at some point, he had a three-day seminar. So I remember something from the talks of these 3 days that I wanted to share with you. It's totally relevant with the arts, but it his position in this clip that I'm going to show you kind of explains how I felt after working in the arts for about 11 years. I'm hoping that it's the right clip now.
Wanted to say in just a last note about what now. In the year 2005, as you may remember, the French and the Dutch called for a referendum. A referendum for or against the liberalization of the labor market in Europe. Actually, the problem was more complicated, a sort of European constitution of constitutional treaty had been passed, but the central point of that treaty was the liberalization of the labor market. Liberalization of the labor market is an ambiguous expression. Oh, it's a good thing, but it's also the possibility paying a Polish plumber. The Polish plumber became the symbolic, metaphorical character of the story. You can hire in France a Polish plumber at the salary that he earns in Poland. This is destroying the labor market, the labor solidarity and the salary of the French workers. So goes the discourse. It's true. Actually, the so-called liberalization of the labor market has been the tool that the global capitalism has used to destroy the ability of workers to defend their conditions of life and to reduce salary while increasing exploitation. Everybody knows that. The point that is interesting to me is that in the year 2005, the French and the Dutch went to a referendum about yes or not we will accept or we will refuse this new deregulation of the labor market. A difficult situation for people like me, because I was facing the alternative to vote against a constitutional step in the history of the Union, so taking an anti-European stance, or saying yes to the neoliberal reformation. Dani Cohn-Bendit and Tony Negri signed a declaration pro yes. We have to say yes the constitutional reform of Europe and also to what it implies. Unfortunately, we have to say yes to the deregulation of the labor market. What happened at the very end? at those at the French at the Holland election, but the supporters of the refusal in that case have been the fascists. So we refused to stay with the fascists. But at the same time, I will say in an autocritical way, we have opened the door to the fascists, because from that moment on, the National Front in France has become the only representative of the interests of the salaried workers of that country. In a certain way, our decision to stay with the progressive part of Europe has given to the fascist party in France and all over Europe the right to represent the interest of the working class. I consider, I mean, the role of Negri, Convendit, or me, of people like us, is very small. We probably represent 0.1% of the voters. So, no.
Okay. I wanted to show you this because obviously this is an example that he gives. And for me, when he was talking about the police plumber, also being in Athens and having a police artistic director in Athens for Documenta 14 was almost like an inside joke. But then it hit me because Bifo is somebody that everybody in the art for the last more than 10 years has been eager to have in different configurations, in exhibitions and events to discuss. And I think it is for the first time that I saw that he was very honest, that basically the left people failed. In the left intellectuals failed. And in that sense, also, there was another failure for me because they were talking only about the working rights of the workers as if our lives still revolve around the working class that is only in the factories. And then I thought about the parallelism, which is a very, how can I say, banal parallelism. A lot of people talk about the museum as a factory, the how we work, et cetera, et cetera, and our working conditions, what kind of values we create. How do we stand when we feel cosmopolitan or citizens of the world? What are the yes and the no's that we say, and how this defines our practice? What is our autonomy and when it stops? If we decide to be more involved, does that dilute the work we're producing, etc., etc.? It's a free-floating state, but I really wanted you to listen to that because I thought it was an interesting thing. So much for the warm-up thing. I'm gonna start by giving you very briefly and quickly my background with some images that might even be irrelevant. Can I have some light? I don't think you need to have that much of darkness. I mean, people can see it. I just need to be able to see my note.
The full lights or plug in on
this
big
one.
That one's quite intense though. If you put it on the corner on the wall, it might be less intense.
Can I increase this one?
Yep. But then you point it at the wall
towards the corner.
Yeah.
Towards the corner.
Yeah, not to everyone.
Not on you. Not on you. Also.
Ooh.
Oh,
way.
Okay, this is nice.
Sweet.
Nice.
Yeah. Yeah, how's that?
Okay.
Scenographic.
Yeah.
So just to stick it on the 1 hour slot, I'm gonna read. If I also, somebody keep an eye on the words. In 2005, during the post-Olympic Games in Athens, CASA, as we used to call it, with a friend artist whose name is Kokayo and an art critic friend who's called Augustin Zenakos, we founded the Athens Biennale, from which I stepped down in July 2016. From the start, we perceived and treated the Athens Biennial as an organization and let's say as an institutional model, which could be tested and modified by peers to the extent of offering to share or hand over its running to larger groups, claiming another perception, basically content, not claiming, I'm sorry, another perception or context, but another practice, a context for cultural production where we were living, organization, and overall operation. Of course, we were test driving very well-known arguments on this expanded notion of institutional critique or autocritic, and we opted for a non-stop, round-the-clock operation, which used each edition's opening both as a climax of certain events and activities, but also as a concurrent start for a new phase of operation, which was informed by the previous in many ways. From the beginning, we treated the organization, like I told you, as a model. So at the same time, though, we did not exemplify preparatory stages, but opted for this round-the-clock operation because at each edition opening was this concurrent start and saved the processes both of which the exhibition was viewed, but also of how the operation worked. Behind this very commonly found biennial approach, I can count numerous biennials, and you know them as well, or a large-scale exhibition, that use the exhibition as a research tool itself, a potential practice, for example, for testing ideas that would not otherwise be possible, and as artists, you know that also very well. There was an aspiration to establish something more than a curatorial precedent. In our view, this eternal return of the same, and this is why we selected to create a biennial organization, could claim not another perception, like I told you, but another overall operation of cultural production. Now, you see images from previews. This one is from 2011. What was, let's say, something that we worked on was, in each edition, we selected another venue, and mostly we were working in the city center, other than the previous one that you saw in 2009, when we went to the very derelict and disused former properties of the Olympic Games. We tried also to circle the center in different ways and ask the people to visit and also open up buildings or use spaces that were not necessarily used as exhibition spaces. This one is an exemplary one and actually one of the exhibitions I'm most proud of. Monodrome in 2011 amidst, you know, all the movement and also the peak of the crisis. We used a former arts and crafts school, which was the 15 minutes of Bauhaus fame of Greece, that was now derelict. Half of it was used as an, maybe I can go back again. Half of it was used as a tourist management sort of college. The rest of it was totally derelict and locked. So we went in and tried to connect the narratives of being a former school, but also at times of work. It has been a hospital, a prison, all sorts of institutions. We tried to create a narrative. We created a school on the ground floor, had a constant kind of flow of events and lectures that were relevant and were happening live. The public school was, I think it was the first time in the city that a school in that kind of format of more free flow, something that might look familiar to you, was operating and people had access to come follow lectures or workshops that were not kind of this new municipalism character. And then in 2013, we used the former stock exchange space in Athens. That was not abandoned because of the crisis, but because they moved to another location. Nonetheless, it was a public-owned building that is quite beautiful inside and was left also to its own devices. It took us a while to negotiate, and we left it as we found it, actually, because they were trying to find different ways of making something out of it. It was dead center in Athens, behind Omonia Square. So it was almost like somebody's insides were ripped out. You will see now all this in the next image. I mean, you can see it from the floor or also the state of the walls, but these are all the internal, let's say, ventilation systems that were ripped out. So we tried to host an exhibition there. We called it Agora, and it was like almost a little more than 2 months of constant activity creating different groups. And that was also a definitive turn in the way we operated, because in this case, we did not invite a curator to do an exhibition or a group of curators, but we invited a huge group of different people from different countries also through an open call, but also friends, coming from the so-called creative industry, filmmakers, artists, curators to contribute. We formulated a functional team at the end of 43 people, which is actually a great thing, and we started working on this. And for this we also got an award from the Metaz Foundation, the European Cultural Foundation. But in 2015, I think after all this experimentation, and you see now that the center of Omonia Square, this is an old hotel, again derelict, that we tried to use and create studio space in this last edition. So in 2015, we were discussing both with Documenta to collaborate in some sort of way that failed after almost 2 years. We revisited our identity by extending our duration, and we thought that we will run for 2 years concurrently in various venues and having as an epicenter this derelict hotel that used to be also a center for kind of degenerate artists of the 30s and poets that are not part so much of the national narrative of literature. So we invited and worked together with writer, filmmaker, and anthropologist Amal Molona. And we focused on the emergence of alternative economies and the establishment of institutions that redefine the system structures and its pre-existing models while highlighting the current views of contemporary art. Our goal, this is, let's say, pose it here. I can leave it here because this makes sense. This is almost like a graph of all the exhibitions, how they started. I make a small strip, like, imagine the first one was a white cube, the second one had kind of this audience on the side with various public events. In Monodrome, the one I explained to you in the Arts and Crafts School, the audience was actually creating with us the content of the exhibition. And in Agora, we kind of open up the box, so let's say everybody could participate and was part of the ethos all the time. And then in Omonia, we were very ambitious. In 2015, we wanted to create a production site like this because it was also a hotel, but the times were right and there were a lot of collectives formulating. We all had been facing the same issues. We wanted to create a space where people could have a studio space, they could meet together, work without any agenda. We also thought of actually creating facilities, like a printing facility, because most of the printing houses in Greece at the time were going bust, and there was a lot also of their practice that was getting lost in the way by digitalized printing. So the goal, like I told you, was the establishment of a permanent location also for us, for the organization, and its transformation into a production space by sharing premises and resources with our collective, independent art spaces, cultural producers, activists, bottom-up initiatives, and solidarity networks, mostly also from Athens and Greece. Apart from the presentation of a variety of interdisciplinary projects, this edition also created two summits that we called synapse, like connections, but more on a neurological, neurosurgical terminology. And we deliberately hosted them around the corner from where the main venue was, the National Theater, in order to kind of stage also the state event and create this situation of theatricality within it. We're always, in a sense, over direct sometimes our practices. So in the first one, in November 15, we touched upon a common ground between a group of scholars, activists, and self-managed organizations, cultural producers, and other civic subjects involved in urban practices of commoning, solidarity, urban welfare, and participatory democracy. And we asked participants to imagine how these urban experiments developed in time of crisis may become permanent and sustainable alternatives to the dominant economic and political models. The second one happened after 5 months in April 2016 and explored the role of art institution and cultural organization in the current political and economic context of global dispossession, austerity, and inequality. So it was basically everything was structured around four theoretical strands: why, what, and for whom making a biennial or an exhibition, common praxis, regionalism and the New South, and acting out on the body politic. So the summit explored issues such as the prospects and limitations of the formation of new art organization and new activist-based curatorial and artistic approaches alongside the geopolitical significance at the time of Greece as a country at the crossroads, imagine. So, like I stated from the very beginning, 2 months after this summit, I stepped down from their organization. And as you can imagine, if you set up something with your friends that oscillates between having a legitimacy of an institution and it resembles or operates more like an artist-run, you know, very free and easygoing situation, it was very difficult. So this, my stepping down is not representing any withdrawal or cynicism, but it was largely informed by the backfiring effects of these three things that I thought were our strengths, and I still try to negotiate also in other endeavors. So one is, I'm telling you now what I thought was a strength, and backfired. Initiating a biennial without being part of a state or municipal cultural policy plan, independent. The second that was very important for us was being involved in running an initiative that oscillates between this perception of institutional gravitas and an ethos that was closer to self-organized initiatives by our practitioners, which meant unbranded, self-governance, sustainability, big question mark. And of course, the third was living and working in Athens, where the relevance of these debates related to the ambivalence of the practice, of art practice overall, not just biennial practice, was fundamental, and it shed more light, obviously, because of the presence of Documenta and its blatant, you know, symbolism. So I have some questions before I take you to my other endeavor. So what I'm thinking is, since 2016, is what makes most is not how it is made, what makes most is how it is made, not that it is made. The how is interesting for me, and how then it happens again. My questions also are, what is at stake when we make curatorial and artistic arguments that resonate with so epoch-defining, let's say, statements? How can we think about the programs, the publics of institutions, both locally and globally, under these conditions that we all live in? And if we seek to be polemical, how can we do this within the structures that we operate? For me, as I was growing up and had the privilege, I think, to be involved in culture, coming from a very middle-class background, art was defined for me as an act of resistance all the time, either formally, for example, like changing the rules of the medium, or socially, changing the rules of the game, basically. So, the very question that I have been trying to address also, because throughout these processes, as you can understand, we created lots of general assemblies, the doors were open to different types of people, we made ourselves public in a lot of ways in order to over-identify with what we were doing. And this has a lot of cost for all participants, I think. So again, what I told you in the beginning stands, like, where is our autonomy in this cultural field and where is our complicity? What can we do within the institutions and outside of them in response to these radical shifts that are happening? And how our possibilities are altered, let's say. So these questions I don't think I will solve immediately, or maybe it will take me a lifetime, but they're, I think, kind of interesting questions, at least for me. Maybe you find something relevant there for you. But since then, since I had these questions and I was homeless and institutionalist, which was quite liberating, actually, I, against my better judgment again, got involved in the setup of another organization, which is called Laboratory for the Urban Commons, LAC. This is an Athens-based research laboratory, which is constituted by local and international researchers and activists and cultural producers, and aims to operate as a platform, I would say, but it's a bad word, I haven't found a better one, across different solidarity economies, grassroots movements, knowledge, and cultural communities. So this has been a very slow process because we are a very different type of team. there is a lack of trust. Let's say in the beginning there was a lack of trust, particularly for the participants who were coming from the cultural side, because you have to imagine that this is a very broad spectrum of group. Let's say we try to test these ideas for the last 14 months. We've been trying to work a lot undercover. We haven't done anything public, in a sense, or made any manifestos. And we created two informal conversations meetings to test drive our ideas and receive feedback from similar, let's say, experiences and projects. For us, LAC, it would be a space that encourages, let's say, the redistribution of roles and competencies. And it basically, for the last months also, because it's happening for real, or it might not happen again, it might be a failure, it really challenges our ability to work collaboratively. Because we always come in a situation where we say, okay, let's work as a group, let's work as a team, but if this is something that we have to continue doing on an everyday basis and it's not project-based, then the dynamics between a team changes. And of course, we try to find also in this very anticlimactic times of movements in Spain, in Italy, but also in Greece with a sense of fatigue and everything, we also find try to see whether there are alternative models for cooperation and collaboration without obviously glorifying the commons, because we all enter by with question marks and open terrains, and uncommoning is also a big part of our conversations. Let's say I can give you briefly, because I don't have images, just to give you an idea, because all this sounds really nice maybe and it's big words. The first workshop that we did in November had we did field visits in various neighborhoods in Athens in order to explore the assets and needs of existing initiatives and stakeholders and probably potential members. I mean, we're talking from solidarity schools to community based farming to, I don't know, grocery co-ops, you name it. And we invited architects Sandy Hilal and Alejandro Petty, who have been working also in Palestine, Vasif Kortun, Leo Panitz, Hilary Wainwright, and brought them together with these local groups to meet together. So we talked about housing, medical care, refugees, and education, and we addressed a little bit the workers in our factories and cooperatives and the digital civic collectives that are kind of strong in Greece at the moment. The second workshop, which happened last May, almost a year before, was more focused on things that we thought we could work